Hey beloved, Krista Pettiford here. Welcome back to my channel. Today I want to share with you 7 tools that you can use to bring breakthrough in deliverance while you're praying and fasting. Jesus said that. He said this kind, and we'll get into that. There's a certain kind of deliverance. There's a certain kind of demonic. There's a certain kind of breakthrough that only happens when you pray and you fast. And so in this month of July, God has called me to set aside some time to seek his face in prayer and fasting. So 7 things that will position you to experience breakthrough and deliverance while fasting. Before I get into this message, please like this video, subscribe to my channel, and share it with someone that you think needs to hear this. So let's get into it. Number one, I guess I'm going to give them to you all at once so you can identify them, and then I'll get into the teaching. Identify the fruit, identify the root, confess your sins, repent, and then we have commit to pray and cry out, commit to fast, create a quiet place to meet God every morning and every evening. So let's get into this. I have some notes because I wrote them down because I don't want to forget anything that I'm sharing with you. So number one, identify your fruit. Make a list of the manifestation and the things, or of the things that are happening in your life or in the life of the person that you are praying for. Because sometimes it doesn't matter if you're praying for yourself, if you need deliverance or breakthrough, or if it's somebody else. The manifestation, the outworking of what is happening. If someone is acting out, if someone is, you know, on drugs, if somebody is struggling with mental illness, if somebody is struggling with fornication, if there's arguing or something, division in your home, whatever it is that is going through, make a list of those things because you want to identify the fruit of what's going on, because that is where most of us stop. We say, God, I need a miracle in this situation, my finances or whatever it is. And so what are you seeing in the natural? What is manifesting in the natural? Because again, that is where we normally start and stop. that's a surface level. And when we pray for God to remove or deliver us from something or someone else without addressing the root, we normally don't see as much breakthrough. But it's good to list the fruit because it's the consequence or the result of the deeper issue that needs to be addressed. And so it's how the bondage or the curse is manifesting in the natural, but the root is spiritual. So number two, you want to identify the root. The root is where someone has violated one of God's laws or his principles that allowed a gate to be opened that has given the enemy legal access to you or your loved one in whatever area that you're now seeing the manifestation of demonic activity, or what looks like destructive behavior, or where there's deliverance or breakthrough needed, whatever it is where you can't break through. And so take time to dig deep and get in God's presence. If you don't know, sometimes just sitting and being open and honest with yourself, you'll see where if it's you and you need a breakthrough, you have maybe violated one of God's laws. Sometimes that might be hard to do if you are, if you don't read the scriptures regularly. But if you read the word of God regularly and you focus in there, especially like Proverbs and the New Testament, Ephesians, Galatians, it will tell you what New Testament believers are supposed to do, how we're supposed to live. And sometimes what we think is little is big to God. And it says in Psalm 50 verse 21, these things you have done and I kept silent. You thought that I was altogether like you, but I will rebuke you and set them in order before your eyes. And so sometimes when God keeps silent, we think what we're doing, a behavior, is okay, and we don't understand why we're not getting the breakthrough. But if he said it and it's his word, even though he doesn't stop us because we have free will, that doesn't mean that we do not suffer the consequences. God doesn't hurt people. Sometimes we see things and we feel like God is punishing us, but it is the consequence of our choices, our principles, when we violate his universal laws. And I have been guilty of that and am guilty, and which is why I'm doing a fast where it concerns certain things and areas in my life, because I need to see breakthrough for certain things in generationally and all different things. And so we have to go back. And so the second thing is to, or the third thing is to confess your sins, confess what you've done. Now, some people would say confession and repentance are the same, but confession is to acknowledge before God that you have sinned against him and others with a sorrowful and remorseful heart, what the Bible calls a broken and a contrite spirit. Psalm 51:17. And even if you are the person who needs a breakthrough, or you aren't the person who needs a breakthrough or deliverance, you can still repent. Daniel did. We see that in chapter 9. And so you can repent with a sorrowful heart, with a broken and a contrite, a broken spirit and a contrite heart. That God will not despise, the Bible said. That is a sacrifice and an offering that he will not despise. He doesn't want your offerings or your sacrifices of good works. There's some things that take a heart and to confess and to cry out, which then leads to repentance. And so when Daniel cried out, he confessed the sins of himself and his forefathers. He tapped into what Jeremiah had wrote prior and saw that the 70 years was coming to an end, and he began to repent so that God could bring breakthrough. Jeremiah prophesied that they would be in bondage for 70 years because that was what God had, that was God's punishment. And so sometimes God does punish, but when he does, or his verdict, you will know it. And so they had violated. And so, and usually when God punishes, it's just like a parent. We are chastised, we get corrected by our parents. And Hebrews, I believe, 12 talks about that. Whom the Lord loves, he disciplines. And so anytime God does something, it's out of love. And so it's not to punish you because you're evil, or he doesn't love you, or he's rejecting you. When he disciplines or chastises issue, that is, it's, you know, a word that means punishment, but it's the love of a father that he wants to bring you back. And this is where Daniel found himself, in a place where the Lord had sent them away and to exile, and he was ready to bring them back. And Daniel knew that it was going to take repentance and confession. So he began to confess the sins of the forefathers and the generations and everything that they had done. He began to speak it. The Bible says in 1 John, I believe it is, confess your sins and God will cleanse you. If we say we have not sinned, we are a liar. But if you confess your sin, God is faithful and just to forgive your sin and cleanse you of all unrighteousness. So confession is what happens prior to repenting. And sometimes, it's our hearts that need to get right, so our prayer can be effective. And so it's important to list any area where you may have violated God's law and then confess that, even if it's something small that you've done, or something that is generational or in your family, or that somebody that you know has done, to confess that it is wrong before God and that it is a sin against him. Bring that confession into it and then repent. That's number four. And repent means to turn from your ways. It's a turning your mind and changing your way. 2 Chronicles 7:14 talks about repentance. He says, if my people who are called by my name will turn from their wicked ways. So it's a turning from your wicked ways. It means the same thing in the New Testament, to turn, to do something different. And how do you turn from it? You do this by renewing your mind and your conscience with the word of God. When your mind is renewed and your heart is pure and your motive is pure, then your conversation and conduct will change and you can turn it from your wicked ways. And so you renew your mind and you repent by that. And another good thing that I have learned and am using as a principle is to replace each vice with virtue. So example, if you use your tongue to complain, use it to bless God instead and offer praise. And so replace those things that you would normally do, the wicked thing, the bad thing, the thing that is not pleasing to God, in a different way. So you want your heart and your stance and your posture to be right before God, and that is repentance. And so repentance is not just saying I'm sorry, it is turning from it. And so I'm just giving you some examples of how you can do that. And then you want to, we talked about at the beginning where Jesus said in Mark 9:29, this kind comes out by nothing but by prayer and fasting. So I want to break this down for you because this is a scripture that I am standing on for some particular things. So this kind, let's get into this. It means, when I look up this kind, it means a countryman, generation, kindred, nation, offspring, from the stock, from the country, born of. And so that means that when he was talking about this kind, he was talking about a certain kind of demonic spirit, the kind that oppresses, opposes, possesses, and puts a person in bondage. There's different demonic spirits, and Paul talks about that, principalities and powers and rulers and wickedness in heavenly places, in high places. And he said this kind that had possessed a man, that's not just oppressing, but had possessed him, and it was causing him to do destructive things to himself, who was opposing the people around him, who had put this young man in bondage and the disciples could not cast him out, comes out by prayer and fasting only. Not by just prayer or fasting, but he said you have to do both. Sometimes we pray, but we don't add fasting to it. And I'll link the video that I did last week for Saturday morning prayer so you can see how I talked about that. I won't go back over that in this video. But prayer, by prayer and then fasting. Sometimes we fast, and in the world these days it's easy to fast but still not turn our attention toward God. And so it says by prayer, that means worship and debating and oratory. This is what the word means. And it made me think of Isaiah 1:8, where it says, come now, let us reason together, says the Lord. That means to pray earnestly, just like in James 5:16, the effective fervent prayer. So he said prayer where you are reasoning with God, where you are arguing and debating and you are pleading your cause before the Lord. That is fervent prayer, to really get into it and cry out for God to change the circumstance. You have to break, you're breaking something, you're pressing in. And some things you can just claim it and it be done. You can speak it, but sometimes we have to get in that position first. So that's why fasting is also important, because as we're breaking through, sometimes we need to break some things in ourselves first so that we are speaking from a place of our spiritual authority and not up and down, back and forth, and out of the flesh. We're praying God's will with authority, but also because when you fast, you tap into the spirit, and then you are pressing to in the spirit. There's some levels that you're not going to reach in the spirit without fasting, without the type of prayer that really presses in. And so fasting, the Greek word for that means fasting, a lack of food, voluntary and religious. Specifically the fast of the Day of Atonement. So it means to go without food. And many times in our generation, as I've come along in Christ, when I first was in the Lord, you know, a fasting meant fasting. It meant to, you know, you are going to drink some water, or you're going to do a Daniel fast, or you're going to pick one. Fasting, you know, now we say, I'm going to give up one thing, or when am I going to give up, or this, that, and the other. But this kind, I'm not saying that there's something wrong with that. I'm saying that there are certain types of things where you have to turn your plate down so that you can feed your spirit. Jesus was in the wilderness for 40 days with nothing, not food or water. Now, this was Jesus. I'm not recommending anybody do this unless the Lord tells you to. That's between you and him. But when the enemy came and tempted him, he overcame the test in the wilderness and then went into his ministry. So often God will call you into a fast to break something, to bring you into a higher place spiritually, to promote you in the spirit, or whatever it is. So I'm going to go to number five, and I'm going to say, you want to commit to a fast, whether it's a Daniel fast, a liquid fast, or a water only fast, or you're giving up something, but stick to it. That as a, by an act of your will, stick to what you say you're going to fast from. And sometimes that's not easy, believe me, when we get busy. But if you want breakthrough and deliverance, Jesus said there is a way. And sometimes we're fasting, but we're not praying. We're praying, but we're not fasting. But he said there is a way. Fervent prayer and fasting can cause things to come out. It can increase your faith. And so he called them a faithless generation. Oh, faithless generation, how long will I be with you? Because they couldn't cast it out. And when they were alone with him, they said, why couldn't we cast this demon out? And he said, this kind, that's how it started. This kind comes not out by prayer, but by prayer and fasting. So there's some things that have to happen, and you have to be all in, and you have to be fasting brings you into that desperation, that contrite heart, that broken spirit, and that contrite heart. It does something in you that brings you closer to God, because you're tapping into his spirit. And I just don't know how else to express it. And so commit to it. When you fast, replace your busyness of your daily routine, like entertainment and activities, with prayer, reading the word, sitting still before God, and worship. Ask him and expect God to speak to you as you quiet your soul from your regular activities. So you're not just not eating food, but still being busy. You're slowing down. And then number six is commit to pray and cry out and contend for the deliverance and breakthrough of the person or yourself you're believing God for, until you get a breakthrough and hear God speak to you in the spirit. So God will give you evidence. He will give you a sign. He will show you that it's done in the spirit, because the battle is always going to be won in the spirit. And that's where you're going to receive your victory first, is in the spirit when you pray. And so then you will see the manifestation. And sometimes we fast and pray and God will tell us a thing is done and we don't see it for years to come, but we know it's already done, and we have the faith to hold on and endure because God showed us something that cannot be denied. So do not be discouraged if you get a prayer and a breakthrough and you see the victory won and God gives you an answer and you come out of your fast and it's not already done, but God is working it out. He told Daniel, he heard him from the moment he set his heart to fast and pray and to repent. Then he was heard, and then the angel Gabriel came and brought him the answer, but it still took time to manifest it. And we are still seeing some of what Daniel, the vision that Daniel was given, all of it has still not come to pass. And so be encouraged, beloved, that God is who he says he is, and he will do what he said he would do. And so your job is to hear from heaven, to seek God's face and hear him and get your answers, and then stand on that in faith. Habakkuk 2:2, I believe, says, without a vision, the people perish. No, it's about write the vision and make it plain. But first you have to have the vision. I will set my watch and I will see what the Lord will speak to me. He didn't say I will hear. He said, I will see. God will give you a vision. I will see what the Lord will speak to me. And so, and then he says, write the vision, and the just shall live by faith. And so we do not draw back, but we stand on the word of God. We stand on the vision. He said, write the vision and make it plain that those who run may read it. For the vision is for an appointed time. Though it tarry, wait for it. So, because it shall not lie, it shall surely come to pass. And so you write what God told you and you stand on to it. That's what you're going to war, a good warfare with, according to the prophecy that was spoken over you. That's what Paul told Timothy, to war a good warfare according to the prophecy. What does that mean? To fight the good fight of faith, to hold on to what was spoken over you, spoken over the one that you're believing God for. When God gives you that prophetic word, whether someone else speaks it to you or you get it directly from heaven, that when God gives it to you, that's what you're going to war. That's what you're going to stand on. When the devil comes and says it's not going to happen, you're not going to see breakthrough, that person is not going to get deliverance, your promise is not going to come to pass, you say, I already have it written. God already showed me. It is finished. It is done. And you war with that word. And so that is number six. And then finally, number seven is create a quiet place to meet with God in the morning and the evening, to pray through your list and to seek God, to cry out in repentance. Sometimes, like Daniel, he went on different fasts. And so whether it's one time or more, until you, whatever you have to repent of as much as possible, at the same time, find a place, your secret place with God, and you cry out, you pray over that list. You contend for those souls, for deliverance, for breakthrough, for your family, for your marriage, whatever it is that you are believing God for finances, for whatever you need for healing and deliverance. You cry out, you go through your list, and you pray over that, and you confess whatever comes to mind. But when you confess it, trust that God has forgiven you, because it's his heart. It's the Father's heart is to be believed. And so sometimes when we ask for something over and over again, I have it written in my journal. He told me it hurts the Father's heart. He heard you. This is what Jesus, Holy Spirit told me, the Spirit of Jesus told me, that when I was early saved and I was praying for my husband, he said, the Father has heard you, and it hurts the Father's heart that you keep asking him for the same thing. Don't you believe him? Don't you trust him? And he took me to, 1 John 4 verse 15 and 16. I believe it's 4. If it's not 4, it's 5. And this is the confidence that we have in him, that we, if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And he heard me say, was it according to his will? And he said, he has heard you. And he said, and if he hears us, he will give it to us. And so I didn't know that scripture. And so the Holy Spirit, in my younger walk with him, would just drop scriptures in me. And even now he does that. I have to go look up. But very often when I was younger in the Lord, he would give me a scripture and I have to go look it up, because he would tell me the whole thing. He would just speak his word to me and I would have to go see it. And so he told me that, you know, at some point we're not asking, we are declaring, we are decreeing, we are warring with the word that we have. Now, if you haven't got a word from God, then you trust him that he's hearing you. And when he gives you that word, you hold on to it, but you meet God in your quiet place and you seek his face for the strategy, for the plan of how you have to deal with this season. Because some things that I'm warring for in this season, God has already said it's done, but I'm fighting a battle against the enemy that is trying to divert, destruct, destroy, supersede what God has spoken. So that's why Paul told Timothy to war a good warfare according to the prophecy that was spoken over you. So I have to go in, hallelujah, and take back what the enemy is trying to take and declare and serve him notice in the name of Jesus, that he touch not those things that God has promised me, that God is going to perfect those things that concerns me, whether it's my children or any other thing. And some of it is for me so I can stand, and not which you'll read in another video I did, that when we fight the enemy on the lower level, we're down here, we're, you know, going tit for tat with the people in our lives and things like that. And the enemy will use people. He will send people to have you doing all of this. But God says, come up higher and and war from that place of authority where you are seated and you can speak a thing and it will be established, but you have to come up to that place. That is the place where he has for you. And sometimes the prayer and fasting will do that for you. But it, and you know, some people, they go and, you know, they can just always be in that place. But sometimes when you've come out of that place, or even to stay in that place and maintain it, it takes a different level of prayer to have the fervent prayer that James talks about, so that when you decree a thing, you're decreeing it from your secret place, from your seated place in Christ Jesus. Because there are some, glory to God, that will not come out by prayer, but by prayer and fasting. And so I hope that this this video has blessed you. God bless you. Please subscribe, like, and share this video. See you next time.